What is the Chinese dream? When President Xi Jinping sounded the clarion call in 2012, it was about country and nation.
实现中华民族的伟大复兴，就是中华民族最伟大的中国梦。
But to the ordinary Chinese, what are these dreams made of?
我的梦想啊，城市的打工者在城市里面能够有尊严的生活。梦想都是美好的，现实是残酷的。In
this series, journalist and writer Zhou Yi Jun travels across China to size up the shifting shape of this dream.
如果你总留恋在那种情况下，那种生活方式，那么这个，我说咱们这个自己的，整个社会都不会进步了。
The American dream is about self-invention and the belief that hard work will lead to a better life. It's a catchphrase that is familiar and well-defined. But what of the Chinese dream? 10 years ago, journalist Peter Hessler wrote the book Country Driving, A Chinese Road Trip. Hessler spent 12 years immersed in China, just when the country was in the thick of economic reforms. It was one of the few Western works touching on the issues faced by ordinary Chinese. The in-depth observations made it a bestseller. It also made the Chinese people reflect on their changing society and country. Now, host Zhou Yi Jun will revisit the characters and towns that first appeared in Hessler's book. Following four unique routes in this country, she'll explore four issues most affected by China's development, the changes in the inner world of the Chinese.
但这种生活方式的改变，这是必须的。
The economic transformation.
那怎么的？我干好几十年了，怎么突然间就不让我干了呢？
The rich poor divide.
几千块钱一年，您这钱够花吗？
不够花啊。And
finally, sustainable development.
我看您的诗里面把它比作是眼泪，内心比较愧疚吧。
She wants to find out, to the ordinary Chinese, what is the authentic version of the Chinese dream? As Peter Hessler wrote in Country Driving, starting in 1978, the migration of millions of farmers to the cities fundamentally changed the structure of Chinese society. The country has been trying to achieve balanced development for the last 70 years, and enormous large-scale migration happened because of that. But four decades after opening up, has the balance been tilted?
就是在中国的农村，实际上村民是在骨子里面都是自卑的。In
Chinese schools, geography textbooks teach children about the Hu line. In 1935, geographer Hu Huanyong came up with an imaginary line that ran from Tengchong to Heihe. It divided China into a southeastern half that was densely populated and a northwestern half that was sparsely populated. The line corresponded with rainfall patterns. In the southeast, plenty of rainwater allowed for farming. In the northwest, where annual rainfall is commonly below 400 millimeters, people herded animals. Until today, the Hu line divides China when it comes to jobs, ease of transportation, internet access, and a good education.
我们这边的孩子 都是在大山里面，从来没有走出过这些大山。人要有理想，有了方向，你才会去奔跑。To
understand China's development in its entirety, we must start from the Hu line. The first stop is Chongqing, one of the largest cities along the Hu line. In 1967, under the threat of war, a secretive army unit entered the mountains east of the city to build the world's most destructive weapon.
Under covert operations for over half a century, this was once the best hidden nuclear engineering facility in the world. Because of its sensitive nature, it was given the codename A16. Today, we will uncover the top secrets hidden inside this world's largest man-made cave.
Hey.
The 816 nuclear project was China's second nuclear base. It was entirely hidden in the mountains, an underground labyrinth that has been dubbed the world's largest artificial cave. But as China's international relations improved, the project was discontinued in 1984. By that time, some 60,000 people had taken part in the 816 project, many of whom came from China's east coast. Following the government's orders, thousands moved cross-country. It remains a striking chapter in the Third Front movement that China launched half a century ago. Following the Hu Line, the next destination is Panzhihua, a city that was built during the Third Front movement. Nearly all the residents here are migrants from elsewhere in the country. In the 60s, China was undergoing tumultuous times. For economic and security reasons, Mao Zedong ordered factories and workers to move inland to establish a new and strategic front. This massive relocation and construction campaign is the Third Front Movement. Panzhihua's Third Front Movement Museum has become a site for patriotic education and aims to tell the public about the spirit of this movement. It shows how this massive migration, half a century ago, influenced the history of China and its people. These young pioneers left their homes and came here to build a city from scratch. The scenes of their hardship are still vivid, and the banging sounds of steel production still ring in the air.
We know that the three-line construction came from Mao Zedong's strategic idea. Mao 主席多次讲到三线建设，他在讲话中有一句原话就是“攀枝花建不成，我睡不着觉。”来自全国29个省区的优秀的儿女汇集到我们攀枝花，开发攀枝花钢铁基地。
有400万的中国当年的就是正当年的青年离开了家乡，到三线这里来。
对。
而在攀枝花这边大概就有60万。
最高峰的时候达到60万。因为当年的三线建设者应该说是共和国历史上一个特殊的群体，都是通过层层筛选的，不是说你想来就能来的，是吗？
您觉得像这种当年就是这个一声号令，可以有百万人一起大规模的移动到一个不毛之地，重新建设出一个新的城市，是不是这种奇迹只有中国才能做到？
我们在党中央的一声号召下，千千万万的三线建设者，就是听从党的指挥，义无反顾地来到如此偏僻、荒芜的地方参与三线建设。我们有一句话叫做“献了青春，献终身；献了终身，献子孙。”
Back then, China was going through a period of ideological fervor. Patriotic youth from all over the country answered the Communist Party's call to move to the underdeveloped Western region.In that political climate, the youths had to make tough decisions that affected the rest of their lives. Their willingness to move to a barren land is something people today cannot begin to fathom. Li Shen Zhao graduated from university in 1964 and moved from eastern China to do research at the Panzhihua Iron and Steel Research Institute.
你看那个天安门那个城门洞哈，那个第一个门洞和第二个门洞中间那个最后一排那个是我，
您那个时候拍照的时候啊，应该是第一次试验成功，
对，
一个重大突破。
Li Shenzhao's friend Li Xiaoting share a similar family history. His father also moved here in the 60s.To take part in Panzhihua's development.
像您的父亲、还有像李老师都是背井离乡，您就是离开家那么远，当时没有这种哀愁吗？当时
没有，
就是跟你谈的话，以后实际上就是一句话，你就调到那西南钢铁研究院，就是了，你到那报道去了。嗯，那个李老师来的时候二十几岁，您当时成家了吗？成家了，我是成家了以后结婚那三天以后就调这儿来了。<笑>您父辈，就您这一辈，像李老师您这一辈的梦是什么？我们那时候当时主要是你完成任务，你干哪一个行你就完成自己。
我们那时候你要搞实验，就把事业搞成。可是您的晚辈哦，他们回头看像你们当时的那一段生活，嗯，几十年只有工作没有生活，离背井离乡这样过来，他们会不会觉得你们当时其实是牺牲了自己了？
对你这个说法是
没话讲，现在就是
那样，是这样。
我自己就是我外公当时是从上海。
就是从连钢厂直接调到了四川江油，啊，江油，他有二十年也是在江油，他也是大三线，对对对对，江油也算。对，然后因为我们好像对这个历史不是很了解，就是好像他也不是这段历史他不会说很多，我也不知道是为什么。他可能各种原因。那时候工作都是什么国家分配的，你自己找不到工作，给你分配到这家上海哈，你要不去，你上哪去？
Zhou Yijun is reminded of her own family story as she looks at the fresh faces of the pioneers here. Decades ago, her grandfather too left Shanghai, leaving behind his young wife and children to go to Sichuan province for his new work assignment. For decades, the family was rarely together. This time of hardship is something nobody ever talked about. Over time, it became something of a family secret. Curious about her own family's experiences, Yijun returns to Shanghai, hoping to get some answers from her grandmother.
啊，我最近到个四川去，攀枝花有一只叫三线建设博物馆，我老早听也没听过。我去了才晓得，原来外公老早子也是去支援建设的。我就晓得伊到一个四川去，不晓得去做啥的。这厂里动员，那不动力武器不行哎。
你不去，他工资不发不拢嘞。那么一个辰光，伊去了多少辰光？二十年。
二十年啊！侬叫我现在想起来，老难想象的，就是国家讲一句，一个人就去要去二十年，为了屋里向。你叫我现在想想，真的是老难的，离家搿事体。搿能办呢？没去不行哎，你没去要去伐？
一个辰光哪能没想一道去啦？人家勿是有个人侪是屋里向人去。
我不肯去的。
为啥？
我抱着想，我本来三个小人来偷了外地去，我上海不等等了外地去，我不去。
侬觉着外公到四川去搿事体，对㑚有啥个老大的一个影响伐？
哪能没影响呢？哦，我一家就报警报错，三个人造成个可能有办法，夜到回来嘛还烧不赢了去，哪能没影响啦？影响大嘞。
一个辰光像侬搿能介个情况多伐？就是讲。
多了，七家的人刚刚没三十个样子东西。家家人侪搿能介样。三十个样子，侪是娱乐为小的呀。侬有辰光心里哪能想？伊二十年勿辣屋里向。我哪能想呢？这个，哎呦，哎呦，我靠！这我自家苦的一方，有啥办法？也没办法的嘛。
For decades, facing a determined state, large numbers of people moved from the developed East Coast to the impoverished Western interior. During those years, the fates of many people and their families were shifted for the sake of both security and economic development. 3 days after the interview, Yijun's grandfather died peacefully, leaving behind his beloved family and taking his memories along with him. After Shanghai, the next stop in this exploration along the Hu line is Lutren County. This is where a middle school is trying to solve another issue of unbalanced development in the country. In Country Driving, Peter Hustler made observations about the people's sincere enthusiasm for learning. Whether in the cities or in the countryside, the belief in education is a deep-rooted one. Students who make it past layers of tests in China's system of selection earn a chance to leave their hometown and enter the big cities in search of their dreams. Most of the students in this school come from poor, remote villages in the area. The best among them get to sit in for classes conducted at top schools located 800 kilometers away. This gives them access to a quality education that their current environment cannot otherwise provide.
这边是从什么时候开始用网络直播这种教学方式的？这是2006年开始引入的。讲课的老师一般是从哪里来的？就是网络直播那一边的老师？那边的是成都其中的老师，他教他们那边的学生，然后通过卫星。对啊，我们这边同时在观看的。对，就是同时也在跟他们同步在上课。对对对对对。那我很好奇了，就是为什么这边的教学跟成都其中的教学会有那么大的差异呢？因为这个其实我们这个可能跟地域差异、文化差异、经济差异等等都有关系。
Due to a vast difference in local development, there is a huge gap in educational resources in the cities and the villages. After economic reforms lifted the restrictions on rural-urban migration, China's countryside experienced a brain drain. But at this school, students who have stayed behind can take classes, do homework, and learn at the same pace as their city peers.
你们现在装了这个屏幕以后，感觉上课有不一样吗？他们那边就授的知识比我们这边就可能比较广一点吧，就拓展的知识比较多，所以就有时候会听不懂。那你们在屏幕上看到成都其中的那些老师和学生，你们跟他们之间有交流吗？没有。你们会羡慕他们吗？有时候会啊。你觉得有不公平吗？
我觉得公平，不公平的话还是有一点的，因为他们从小生活在那些大城市里面。Apart
from the obvious TV screen in the classroom, I don't really see a big difference compared to when I went to school. There are still lots of textbooks piled up, long hours, and many students wearing glasses. On the other hand, the speed of learning or training has increased dramatically.
Teacher Zeng has been in charge of this school's online classes for many years, and he too has big dreams for his students.
我们这边的孩子都是在大山里面，从来没有走出过这些大山，他们的见识，他们所受的这些基础性的教育，都是非常有限度的。
还是他们掌握的知识太多了，除了知识以外，反而缺乏了很多个人交流的机会呢。因为我们这个直播课啊，毕竟是看了一个屏幕，中间的这个沟通环节始终是欠缺的。他们平时看到我们成都其中的孩子们质疑他们老师的时候，说明他们会觉得很惊讶。我们这边的同学听了成都其中的同学那些讲解之后，他们又会觉得从惊讶变成了佩服。
其实这个一块屏幕改变命运到底它改变在哪里呢？您觉得它这个秘密到底在哪里？
我自己感觉这块屏幕带给我们的是一种思维，是一种方向。它就像我们理想一样，人要有理想，有了方向你才会去奔跑。我就希望我教室里面这些孩子。
两年以后都能够如愿地考入他们所希冀的那种大学，去创造他们自己的天空，创造他们自己的这个未来，改变他们自己的命运，从这些大山里面走出来。
The only way for these children to escape poverty is to leave the underdeveloped villages where they are born. But whether this screen in school can truly change their lives from such a great distance remains in question. In China, the average GDP per capita is 15% lower in the western provinces compared to those in the east. Shijiezi is a typical underdeveloped mountain village located to the west of the Hu Line. One target of the national dream is the eradication of poverty by 2020. But the difference in development on both sides of the Hu Line makes this a challenging goal to meet.
Hey, 林叔，您在上头干嘛呢？
摘花椒。
摘花椒呢？
哦，
上来看看。
好。
直往上哈。
哎，再上。
每天都要爬那么远。
每天要上来。这
个。您这边海拔有多少？
1000多米吧。
1000多米。
啊。
哎呦。
1000。
是挺高的。
嗯。
那边呢？那边是在造一个桥吗？
对，为这个天平高速路。
哦，高速路。
嗯。
啊，那挺好的，以后你们农作物卖出去都方便了。
哦，方便，我们用不上，它没有出口嘛，它在空中架着。
哦，就说它这个桥跟你们现在山里的路没连上。
哦，没有连上。
哦。您这一天能摘多少花椒呀？
我摘不多。
嗯。
能摘呀，20来斤。
20来斤。
哎，去年连电收成都没有。
哦，为什么呀？
它霜冻了嘛。
霜冻。
哦，天一冻就没有了。
那这个您估计从这花椒上您这一年能有多少收入啊？
几千块钱吧。
几千块钱一年。
哦，
那这样的话您这钱够花吗？
不够花了，
也肯定存不下钱来
啊。没有存钱，还有个孩子上学的了。
Shijiezi is a hamlet of just 13 families. Because of a lack of natural resources and good roads, this is one of China's poorest villages. The average annual income of people here is just $560, only $30 above the poverty line. But the villagers' exceptional passion for art sets Shijiezi apart. When Li Baoyuan is done harvesting peppers, he has time for art.
This is my work.
Huh?
This is my work.
This is your work.
Yes.
You have a name? This
road? Yes, this road has a name. It's all there.
公民之路
啊，对对对，
这条路叫公民之路
啊，
是因为都是大家捐款凑起来的。
对对对对对，
我觉得艺术品其实它蛮少见，它能马上解决一个现实的问题。
对，
哎，这个有意思了。你怎么定义这个艺术呢？因为艺术我们常常觉得它是超脱现实的。
这是个村民办了点好事吧？啊，他下面的人做了下雨不滑。
你当时怎么认知艺术这个事情呢？
因为是我们是这次办了个美术馆嘛。认到艺术家，原来人不认识。
您觉得艺术是什么呢？
艺术给我们能带来这个，你看能修这个路了，这个路灯了，这些个带来的还是好处。
那您觉得其实艺术能带你们脱贫吗？
艺术做好了，村民其实来的人多了，能村民会做了，应该是能脱贫。
In Country Driving, Peter Hessler describes the new socialist village campaign championed by the previous generation of Chinese leaders. Funding poured into China's villages, but due to its remote location, Shijiezi never benefited from this program. Instead, Shijiezi is taking a different path to get out of the poverty trap.
那我们这个村子是从我们从08年开始把整个这个村庄做一个美术馆。
哦。 是融为一体的一个大美术馆。
嗯，对。你所感受到的，你所看到的，整个这个村庄就是艺术。嗯，包括我们的生活。
你们的生活都是艺术。
对。
你也是艺术。
嗯，我也可以是艺术。
我刚才以为是一个丢垃圾的大土堆，这是什么呀？
基因棒，这是石碣子基因棒，石碣子所有的信息都在这个泥棒子里面，这些都是用村里面的树枝、村里面的这个头发啊，包括泥布做成这个一个泥棒子。
这个也是艺术吗？
对，这个自行车挂的这么一个空间，还一看这个石碣子有这么多的台阶，然后从下面要走上面很费劲的。他理想之中希望空中有这么一个交通工具，
可以吊上来
啊，能够使用，那可能这个地方。
Jing Le was the first person in Shijiezi to attend university, and he has returned to help the villagers improve their lot in life. His plan is as meticulous as it is grand. By turning Shijiezi into an art village, he hopes to attract the attention of the outside world, receive government grants.And develop a local tourism industry.
石碣子由十三户村民构成，那构成十三个分馆，也就是说每一家每一户都是一个分馆。
我们能进去看看吗？他们哪户看看？
可以啊。
哦。就里面它有什么展品吗？
对，我们的展品，你现在看到的就是展品，这不多好的。
挺好的，挺像个艺术馆的展品。
这是我们的馆长，
您是
馆的馆长。
您这是什么呢？这个
花椒。
花椒啊，哦，它这个艺术品有名字吗？
名字就是花椒。
您说这个是一件艺术品呢，它要表达的是什么？它就您希望我看到它，我想到什么呢？你想表达什么？
我们的主要的算是还是生活一方面的，算艺术品。哎，靠这个生活。
哎，说得好。哎，靠这个生活。
靠这个生活。
您这个将来要去卖是吧？这个。
哦，这先赶紧卖了。啊，
赶紧卖，这个就这艺术品就拆了。啊。这个艺术品是论斤卖的是吗？
啊，人家是成斤卖嘛，为了
这能卖多少钱？
这样卖怕多少钱？
一斤多少？一斤一八十九十。
您是什么时候开始接触这个词儿的？就是从。金老师这儿才接触到什么是艺术，是吗？
从金老师跑开，他就知道这是个艺术品了吧？嗯，金老师我跑的时候，我不知道这个艺术品是个啥吧？
您觉得就是村民们他们通过做艺术以后哈，他们有什么改变吗？
就是在中国的农村，实际上村民是在骨子里面都是自卑的，所以石碣子通过这十几年的艺术，就是村民。每一个人都很自信的，我认为就是脱贫，就是我们现在看到的只是农村的一个贫富的差距，实际我们可能更想到的，我们不仅仅是需要物质的，我们可能还有需要精神的。
那您觉得从这个实际的收入角度来说，它对脱贫有帮助吗？
实际上它还是有帮助的，就是说你像我们，你看我们这个村子有这么多太阳能，然后这个路这个你看这个水泥路，就是因为我们有这个自从有了美术馆，然后政府也帮助我们去做了好多工作。
那您觉得这种艺术脱贫的方式在周围其他村子能推广吗？
美术馆的意义不是说所有的贫困村都建美术馆，政府的一些官员，包括这个学者、知识分子，甚至大学生能够出去再回来再改造他们的家园。
您有什么梦想吗？
我的梦想是希望石碣子人跟城里人一样过上美好的日子，干什么都很便利的。
The Chinese government's plan to eradicate poverty for all its people is a great and ambitious undertaking.And Shijiezi is exploring a new path to prosperity. During his travels more than a decade ago, Peter Hessler experienced a time when 90 million people were leaving their villages for the more developed coastal cities. Today, China's urbanization is speeding up. In the suburbs of megacity Hangzhou, a new city populated by migrants is taking shape. Today's tour guide is a veteran real estate agent.
天哪，我真的，我觉得错觉是在巴黎吧。对，因为他这里就是仿的一个埃菲尔铁塔的一个那个样式做的呀。完全一模一样。对对对，他窗户一打开，感觉就是生活在巴黎一样的。
Gan Yun, one of Guo Liaming's clients, plans to buy a new flat in Tiandu City.
您去过巴黎吗？那倒是没有去过，电视上看见过，就感觉像在巴黎了，是吗？
您是原来是哪里人？我呀，是安徽人。您安徽人，然后您是什么时候到的杭州？我是2008年，
哦，也有10来年了。
对，
嗯，
您呢？您
是？
我们是江西人，其实我是刚大学毕业啊，我就来了。 来了一待就这么长时间，我们是从09年开始到这里，到现在了。
你们俩都差不多待了10年。对对对对对，我是09年还是08年。嗯，可不可以说这样的一个比较有吸引力的城市哈，它会把周边城镇，甚至是乡村的人都慢慢都往这边吸。
聚拢过来，然后呢，感觉饱和之后，它开始提升，开始在替换，就是替换一些要进来一些这种高素质人才。
那你们觉得你们自己跟本地杭州人的区别在哪里呢？区别啊。 可能是觉得我们奋斗更多一点吧。您怎么样来理解这个中国梦的？
像我们这一辈的人呢，父母可能给予的不太多了，因为他们没有这个能力，对不对？那只有靠你自己去创造。在你自己创造的同时，你又要抚养自己的孩子，还有求生自己的父母，是不是？我们八零后，我觉得真的很努力的。中国梦就是每个人都有梦想嘛，是不是啊？那只要朝着自己的梦想去，努力，基本上就能达成，就这个道理。啊，一个稳定的工作。 啊，一个幸福的家庭，啊，一个属于自己的家，我觉得这是最起码的中国梦，啊，最起码每个家庭的中国梦吧，应该是。A
taste for Western culture has led to the proliferation of such copycat Shanzhai towns all over China. These new cities tend to be populated by rural migrants. Professor Liu Qihong, who has spent several decades studying China's urban development issues, believes that besides its Shanzhai towns, there are many unique characteristics to China's urbanization.
从建国以来，这个城镇化的运动就一直没有停止过吧？从我所掌握的资料来讲呢，真正的这个城镇化应该是1978年以后。
这里面你们看到1978年，1978年是17.92%，就是大概18%左右。
2008，2008年近60%。 那么，因为中国的这个人多地少，实际上是农村里面是容纳不了那么多农民人口的。那么，随着他们那个解放出来以后，他们就要到城市里的打工啊、就业啊，或者是经商。最主要的是城市也需要这个大量的这个劳动力解决他们的服务。
如果您可以概括一下中国现在城镇化运动最重要的困难和障碍是什么？
尽管我生活在这个城市，但是我在这个城市是没有归属感。 这个城市不是属于我的，特别是新一代的人，像有些这个甚至说第二代、第三代，现在第三代也开始出现了，第二代农民工，这个他也不会种地，又回不去，有的时候跟着他父母，一开始出生的时候就带到这个城市里面来讲，然后这个城市容纳不下。所以，中国的这个独一无二性，使得我们几乎没有经验可以借鉴。可能我这是我个人的判断，可能。 要牺牲一代人，甚至两代人牺牲。
您如果能够简单的给这批人画个像，这些人的年龄、工作、收入大概是个什么样子的人群？基本上，
这个40岁以下、25岁、25岁以上，这是一个社会的中坚力量。
结果，他们可能会成为被牺牲掉的一代人。
那也可能。
找不到根，找不到归宿的一代人。
对对对。
China's rural migrants find themselves in a challenging situation. Because of rapidly rising real estate prices and strict household registration policies, rural migrants have a tough time sinking roots in the city. Yet they do not feel at home in the countryside after being away for so long. But people here in Tiandu City seem relaxed and happy. They've worked hard to move to the modern city, and they feel that they've made it. Against the surreal backdrop of these European-style streets, the identity of China's migrant population feels especially complex. Beijing, the influx of migrants has become a huge burden on the capital city. In 2017, the government announced plans to tackle its big city problems of overpopulation, congestion, pollution, and rising real estate prices by building a new city from scratch, some 150 kilometers south of the capital. Named Xiong'an New Area, the plan was to move some institutions and companies here and take pressure off Beijing.
Here in Xiong'an is the site of China's millennial strategy. Marked as a supplementary capital to Beijing, Xiong'an is a city with high hopes. But looking around, I must say, one has to be quite patient to wait for this future.
Xiong'an is part of the Chinese government's ambitious and long-term millennium strategy. As the name suggests, unlike other cities in China, Xiong'an's development will be strategic and sustainable. As with Panzhihua, this will be another city built because the government has willed it into existence. But unlike Panzhihua, Xiong'an will address China's new urbanization needs and explore new ways to grow the economy. For some entrepreneurs, this was an opportunity too exciting to pass up.
你现在到悬崖新区来，你伴随着这个市场同步的去发展，你只要守住这个位置，5年之后10年之后问悬崖新区咖啡界的态度是谁，就是你。
Shortly after the Chinese government announced its plans for Xiong'an, Fang Xuan quit his job in Beijing and together with his partner Zhao Zhi, opened the first coffee shop in this future capital of China. They also provide consultation services to businesses that want to set up shop in Xiong'an. Fang Xuan is among the first wave of people who followed their dreams to this new city.
我甚至我老了说起来，或者说以后我有了孩子，一定要说当时这个中国宣布成立雄安新区的时候，新区的建设是我从新区宣布到现在，然后我是怎么样一个经历的过程。我希望我的在年轻的时候有一段这样的故事发生。所以我也有这个坚定的信念跟决心。
如果再要展望未来的话，你有什么梦想吗？哎呀，现在就是希望这个，主要就希望我们的这个生意吧，就我们的这个。 在雄安的这样一些构想，未来能够在雄安新区，我们自己能跟得上新区的这个发展的步骤步调，能把这个事情能够真正的做成。
2 years since the establishment of Xiong'an, many entrepreneurs like Fang Xuan and Zhao Zhi have come here with their startup dreams and big plans. It will require many more years of development before some of those dreams are realized. For Xiong'an's entrepreneurs, patience is truly a virtue. The last stop on the Hu Line is Lake Baiyangdian, a core area of Xiong'an's planned layout. Here, Yi Jun meets once more with Professor Liu Qihong.
刘教授，您看这个周围特别的美，好多的荷花，跟北京的景色完全不一样。
对对对。
但是我们畅想它多少年以后，据说会变成这个首都的一个副中心。嗯，
我认为从这个国家这个角度来讲呢，更考虑来讲一个在雄安打造一个就是说这个创新中心啊。科研创新中心，那有些年轻人过来能在这里边有一个事业的平台，从那个雄安的发展过程中，这个它的发展理念，它的一些具体的做法，这里边对其他城市有一些参考价值。
我们这一路上也走过了四川、甘肃很多地方，看到了中国过去由政府来主导的人口迁移，使一些城市的迅速发展，也看到了很多现在要去解决的贫富不均的问题，然后怎样为这些城市将来的发展去找出路。
实际上我们国家从1978年到现在改革开放40年，这里面我们知道这个人口这个迁移，这是在历史上是最大的。一个是这个从这个经济落后地区往经济发达地区迁移，从农村往城市迁移，它代表了人们的一种那个向往。
This exploration of China's balanced development along the Hu Line showed us how people have moved around the country since its founding. Right up to the recent plans for a new capital, every policy has had a different origin, and they've all left their mark on history. The Chinese people are still figuring out how to achieve the Chinese dream of economic balance and education equality. This is a long-term project and might require many more generations of hard work.